So let's talk a little bit more about the power available. As we said, the power available generally comes from experiment, and it's something that's given by the maker of the engine or the power plant. But there's some general trends that are very important to know about. So up here on the top left, we have a plot of, for a typical general aviation aircraft, of the power available and the power required as a function of airspeed. Okay, so notice that the power available changes depending on your throttle setting, whereas the power required is a single curve. And there's the power required at some points is higher than the maximum power available, but at most points, in this case, at this altitude, the power required falls within the range of power available. But as we mentioned, and I'm going to write this here, the rate of climb can be approximated as the power available minus the power required divided by the weight. So what this means then is that the rate of climb is proportional to the difference between the power available and the power required. Okay, so it's kind of this gap here. So for a throttle setting of 0.7 at an airspeed of 100, the rate of climb, if you're at the throttle setting of 0.7 for this aircraft, the rate of climb would be proportional to the difference between the power available and the power required. And in this case, you'll see the power available, it is higher than the power required, so we would indeed be climbing. However, you can see that there is a point at which the power required is equal to or exceeds the power available. And that's this point here. I'm going to mark it in yellow. This point is what's known as the maximum level flight airspeed. Okay, so this is an airspeed in this case of about, 165, right? Something like that. So this is the maximum level flight airspeed. So if you fly at any airspeed higher than that, you cannot maintain level flight. You'll start to sink. Okay? Now, this we can look at this also on the plot here in the bottom right. This is the plot of the rate of climb. So again, it's proportional to the difference between the power available and the power required. And what that comes out to is something like this. Again, this is for a typical, just kind of generic general aviation aircraft. So you can see that now on this plot, and sorry, these don't line up exactly, I freehanded them, but there's a point right here where your rate of climb is zero and you cannot go any higher. This is that same point. This is the max level flight airspeed. So I hope you can see the connection between these two plots. So here there's something interesting that you can see. You can see that there are actually two airspeeds at which you can obtain zero climb rate or level flight. But in reality, the lower airspeed of these two is generally below the stall limit. So for this aircraft, I'm just going to make something up. Let's say the stall limit is like right here. Okay. So really, there'd only be one airspeed that you can obtain, that you can obtain level flight without stalling. Now, as I said before, our plot of power available changes with altitude, and we've mentioned before as well that the power required changes with altitude. And so what does that look like? So shown here are two more plots. It's for the same aircraft, but at different altitudes, at higher, successively higher altitudes. Okay, so let's say we go up about 10,000 feet for this plot here. So now you'll notice, let me compare real quick with this previous plot. So here we have some rate of climb with a throttle setting of 0.6 up to 1. But here now you can see that we cannot obtain a climb rate with a throttle setting of 0.6. We have to go up to 0.7 to get any climb rate. And the climb rates for the other throttle settings have gone significantly down. The reason for that is because the power available plot has kind of compressed, and the power required plot has moved over and up a little bit, okay? So now our maximum level flight airspeed is lower. It's closer to 150. Do you see that? Well, again, my plots don't line up exactly, but it's gone down. Okay. And if we go up another 10,000 feet to the plot on the right here, again, we have to be at a throttle setting of 0.8, and we can kind of get a tiny little climb rate, but we have to be at 0.8 or higher, and now our level flight airspeed is even lower. Our maximum level flight airspeed. So if you compare these two plots, the plot on the left to the plot on the right, again, our power available range here has compressed, and the power required plot has moved up. And so we require more power to maintain steady level flight as we go up in altitude, but we have less power available to us. And eventually what happens is this keeps happening, and our rate of climb plot continues to kind of shrink until we get to a point like this. So this plot on the top shows the point at which the maximum climb rate we can get. So the plot here, top left, corresponds to the plot on the right. The maximum climb rate we can get is 100 feet per minute. Sorry, that is not a straight line. But you get the idea, right? So here we have a maximum climb rate of 100 feet per minute. Well, the altitude at which this occurs is what's known as the service ceiling. So the service ceiling, I'm just going to write this out, is the altitude. You know, I'm sorry, I keep writing crooked. Let me go ahead and try and write this straight so that it's a little bit easier to read. Okay, service ceiling is the altitude at which the max rate of climb, so VC max is what I'm going to call it, is 100 feet per minute. All right, so that's the service ceiling. And every aircraft has a service ceiling. There's a point at which the aircraft gets high enough in altitude that it cannot climb faster than 100 feet per minute. Now, there's one other point, and that's this point here. And this point is where now we cannot climb anymore. This is where the max level flight airspeed, this is the point at which you cannot get a climb rate. Okay, so this point is what's known as the absolute ceiling for the aircraft. And I should specify this is an aircraft or an airframe power plant combo when I talk about an aircraft this way. So you could have an airframe, and if you put a more powerful power plant on it that has more power available, then it can raise the absolute ceiling. Or if you can lower the power required by changing the aircraft design for a single power plant, then you can also raise the service ceiling and absolute ceiling. So the absolute ceiling is the altitude at which VC max is equal to 0 feet per minute. In other words, you cannot climb beyond that point. So just to give you an idea of how the service ceiling compares for a bunch of different aircraft, I have this plot here that shows the service ceiling for a wide range of different types of aircraft. Okay, so I'm going to zoom in here a little bit, and we'll start down low altitude. So you can see that most general aviation aircraft fall about right here. Let me go ahead and highlight that for you. So they fall about right here, although there are a few, for example, the Cessna Denali that shows up here, which is a little bit of a larger aircraft. But you can see that they fall in this range, with a bunch of them around 15,000 feet, some a little bit higher. But note also that the FAA oxygen limit is at 15,000 feet. So what this limit is the altitude at which oxygen is required for all passengers. So if your aircraft has a service ceiling above this limit, then you're required to carry oxygen for all passengers on the aircraft. If it's below, you don't have to worry about it. So if we keep going a little bit higher, Just for reference, I've shown Mount Everest here, which is about 29,000 feet. And around there, we have some large cargo airplanes, such as the C-5 or the B-1. The B-1 Lancer is a bomber, of course. And then if we go a little bit higher, close to around 45,000, 43,000 feet, I think, we have several World War II fighters, so like the P-51, the Spitfire. But then we also have our commercial aircraft, and that ranges from small regional jets to big long-distance, long-range transports, such as the 787 or the A380, okay? A little bit higher, around 50,000 feet, we have several military aircraft, such as the F-35, F-16, MQ-9, and B-2 bomber, right in that region. Also, several business jets fly or have a service ceiling about that high. Now, if we keep going a little bit higher, then we get into our reconnaissance aircraft. Let me erase all those circles here real quick. Oh, man. Here we go. Okay, so if we go a little bit higher, we have our reconnaissance aircraft. So we get up to about 60,000 feet, and here we have the Global Hawk. And then if we jump up to 80,000 feet, that's where the service ceiling is for the U-2. Okay, now these aircraft, of course, are designed to fly at high altitude. So anyway, that's just kind of a look at the range that we have of service ceiling. So it's a pretty large range. And, of course, it depends on the amount of power that's available to the aircraft, as well as the aircraft design, which influences the power required for steady level flight.